Well, first of all, I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me to this beautiful meeting. And I'd like to talk on tech particle diffusion in single file systems. A single file dynamics is a term that is used for the dynamics of particles that can't pass each other as they move on a line or in a channel of some type. There are many applications in biology, diffusion through pores in membranes, in chemistry, motion in pores in zeolites, traffic flows on no roads without passing. There are, well, the famous SAPs and ASAPs, which many of us study as a model of non-equilibrium systems. And so it's certainly of interest. Most interest, or at least a lot of interest, goes to the dynamics of tech particles that move within such a single file. And now, this is closely related to the collective transport on this line or in this tube. It was first noted by Alexander and Pincus a long time ago, in basically just a command which they published in the Physical Review. And it was a very smart, say, notion of these people who said, well, if you have these particles that can't pass each other, if you want to know what is the mean square displacement of, well, any particle in this system, you can just look at the current through the origin, integrated from the initial time up to time t, and multiply that with the difference at the average distance between neighboring particles. You square that, and then to a good approximation, you will find the mean square displacement of any particle in this system. Now, one slight warning here: to see clearly interesting behavior, you should use this identity by preference in a coordinate frame where the tech particle has no drift. And in that case, you can translate this as the displacement is the velocity times the drift, well, the drift velocity times time, plus the integral of the current in this co-moving system. And if you square that, okay, you get this expression. But if you look at the integrated current in the rest frame, you get additional fluctuations because the integrated current then increases proportionally to time, but there are fluctuations to that, the square of which increases with time. And so this may obscure behavior of this, of this second term here, which may have a behavior that grows more or less fast than time. Now, how to express the fluctuation of the integrated current? It turns out that is quite simple. You just start from the continuity equation for the density, rewrite that into Fourier language, just apply a Fourier transform to that. And if you integrate that over time, so you want to know what is the time integral of the current, you see just divide by minus ik, integrate the ndt just gives you n of k and t minus n of k 0 divided by ik. And well, okay, this works for k not equal to 0. For k equals 0, it would give you an undefined expression because both the numerator and the denominator will be 0. But for the k equals 0, you can make the identification that the time integral of the total current for k equals 0, just the sum of the velocities of all the particles, can be identified as the number of particles times the displacement of the center of mass. So what you get in the end is xj of t minus xj of 0 squared averaged is 1 over, n times the length of the system squared, sum over k equals 0, n of k of t minus n of k of 0 at times the complex conjugate, plus from this k equals 0 term, well, the term which is sitting on the bottom. Okay, here this is repeated. And now you can rewrite this in terms of, well, a dynamic and a static structure function. So define s of k and t as the expectation value of n of k and t times n of minus k and zero. And then you see that you have, well, first of all, get equal time correlation functions from, from this times that and this times that, and you pick up s of k and t plus s of minus k and t, which will be equal in many cases, but not necessarily. And then there is this term from the center of mass displacement. And in the limit for L going to infinity, you can replace this sum over k values by an integral over k. And well, there may still be the center of mass displacement for time squared added to that. Now applications. The simplest cases are those where particles move independently, but exchange identities when they would pass each other. And this would be equivalent to asking, well, what is the displacement of the, say, the 138th particle in the queue, where you just count the number, but you don't require the identity at the initial and the final time to be equal. That's certainly a valid question you can ask. Well, in that case, the s of k and t is just independent contributions from all the particles, which are identical. So you just get, density times the structure function for a single particle, where this is defined as e to the minus ik x of t minus x of zero for such a particle. And now suppose that this function satisfies a scaling form, so it's a form s of k times a function of k times t to the power 1 over alpha. And then you, if you fill this in into this expression for x3 t minus x3 of zero squared, the second derivative of s of k and t will behave as t to the power t over alpha. But if you stick that into the expression for the mean square displacement, you find it goes as t to the power 1 over alpha, provided the drift speed on average equals zero. And this is known as Perkis' rule, that the mean square displacement of a tech particle is, you know, the square root of, well, the mean square displacement of an untech particle.
Keep struggling with this. Examples, first of all, the Jepson gas, so point particles of equal mass moving ballistically and exchanging velocity on colliding. So that's like you have, ideal gas particles just moving at constant speed. You look at, a tech particle, which is just, bouncing between its neighbors. In that case, s of k and t is just the sum over, j and l to the minus ik xj0 minus xl0. But j and l don't correlate for different integers, so it's just the sum over j to the minus ik vj times t, which can be written as an integral density integrals over velocity. Because velocities don't change, so that's automatically stationary. Velocity distribution e to the minus ik vt. Or this may be a Maxwellian, but it can be any distribution. And then if you stick that in to the expression for s of k and t, you find this just gives you the expectation value of the absolute value of the velocity times time divided by the density. Which is, a well-known result since Jepson. But you get it a very easy way from this formalism. Now, non-crossing Brownian particles, which have been considered first by Harris. In this case, you get, well, 1 over pi n integral dk, 1 minus e to the minus dk squared t, which is the structure function, once again, for a single particle divided by k squared. And this, of course, is an elementary integral, which gives you square root of t for the mean square displacement, by now a very well-known result. And if the Brownian particles have a drift, you just add the drift, the average drift speed times t squared. You can apply it also to Levy flights, so random flights with a power law jump length distribution. In this case, the one particle s of k and t is known to dk as e to the minus dk to the power alpha times t. And if you stick that into this expression, you find the mean square displacement of a tech particle which can't pass its neighbor goes as t to the power 1 over alpha. It was a well-defined prefactor. And it requires alpha larger than 1 for convergence of this integral. For long times, the distribution of the displacement of a tech particle in Alexander Pincus' approximation becomes Gaussian, always, thanks to the central limit theorem. The roughly, say, n over 2 particles that are initially to the right of the origin are identically distributed and have the same probability of having passed the origin at time t. So the distribution for the number having passed the origin becomes approximately Gaussian for large enough times. And this then will also hold for the difference of numbers passing in either direction, and that's the total current through the origin. For the Brownian particles, this, I think, has been proved first by Arratia, but I think his proof was quite a bit more involved than this simple argument. And it will work for any type of independent particle dynamics with uniform stationary density. I think it will also be true, as long as these are independent Levy flyers. Well, in the tails, of course, you always find deviations. Central limit theorem for, well, a finite number of particles only works up to a certain value of the tail. But in the middle, it has to be Gaussian. I don't see any reason now it could be not. You think also for a tech particle? I don't think so. I don't see how you can escape this type of argument. Well, unless the second moment doesn't exist, maybe that could be the case for... Okay, good. All right. Good. Now, the second category I want to discuss are interacting systems. Now, the Alexander Pincus approximation remains applicable, but you get a richer variety of possibilities. The first example is a simple exclusion process. One-dimensional lattice pass particles that hop to the neighboring sites, but they can't pass their neighbors. And the hopping rates are symmetric. Well, collective dynamics is diffusive, so the same results will hold as for independent Brownian particles. And this is also known for a long time already. For the ASAP, it's a similar model, but the hopping rates are asymmetric. But in this model, the average drift velocity of a tech particle always differs from the velocity at which perturbations of the density move through the system. So fluctuations in the integrated mass flow through the origin typically grow as the square root of its average, that is, as the square root of t. And I don't see any way to escape that. Okay. All right. I get to Hamiltonian dynamics. For one-dimensional, single-component Hamiltonian systems with short-range interactions, well, Herbert Spohn discussed that at length in his talks, structure function exhibits two sound peaks, the Riemann peaks are called, and one central peak that is usually called the Rayleigh peak. That is, their behavior is expected to be governed by the one-dimensional KPZ equation, leading to S of K and T is the sum over the two possible sound directions, S plus of K and T plus S minus K of T, plus contribution from the heat peak. And the sound peaks behave as e to the minus I sigma C K T, that describes their motion outwards with the sound velocity. And then the KPZ scaling function, which for long times, well, the scaling function for all times, but it will be valid for long times, of a constant times kt to the power 2/3. And whereas the heat correlation functions behave as e to the minus alpha k to the 5/3 t, alike for Levy flights. So this gives rise to three contributions to the mean square displacement. And there is a sound mode contribution, which goes as ct, and because of this, well, this drift, this velocity c. And there is a heat mode contribution that goes as t to the power 3/5. And now, I want to show some comparisons of these with simulations done by Harald Posch on a square shoulder model, very extensive and accurate simulations. But I first have to discuss the finite size effects because they are extremely large for these simulations. I consider Hamiltonian systems with a fixed center of mass and periodic boundary conditions. That is typically the conditions for which the simulations are done. And because of the center of mass is fixed, the k equals zero term in the Alexander-Pincus summation vanishes. The center of mass just doesn't move. So one misses a contribution in the infinite system limit. The average, well, the center of mass velocity squared average times t squared. And so one has to add this by hand to get agreement with the, well, the asymptotic expressions for infinite systems. Also, the fixation of the center of mass constrains the displacement of a tech particle. That's quite easy to understand. Now you have these particles sitting on a ring. So you take one particle and you displace it, say, all the way to this point. Then all the other particles have to move in this direction in order for the center of mass to be fixed. And you find that the largest value you can reach, of the largest displacement which you can reach for a tech particle, is L times N minus 1 over N. And so the mean square displacement has to saturate for long times. And in the limit where t goes to infinity, you find that xj of t minus xj of 0 squared can be rewritten as the displacement of particle j from its average position minus its initial displacement from the average position squared. And then for long times, correlations between this and that term will vanish. So you just get twice the average of the displacement of a particle from its average position squared. And we'll see that in the simulations. Good. Here are simulation results of Harald Posch for, well, a bit over 1,000 particles. given density, given energy. And the red curves are the simulation results. The red curve and the blue curve is the prediction based on the Alexander Pincus expression, but based on the simulation values for S of K and T. You see they follow each other perfectly, but there is, well, a constant offset between the red and the blue curve, and this is due to these oscillations of a detect particle around its average position. And so Alexander Pincus described really the mean square displacement of this average position from its initial value. Then here, this is 2048 particles, and you see in you see it more clearly here even that indeed this approaches to a constant, but the approach is extremely slowly because, well, these oscillations are caused by sound modes just running around the system. And the final approach to the asymptotic value has to come by, say, the damping out of the sound modes. But the damping rate is so small for these rather large systems that it takes extremely long for this to reach this asymptotic value. 2048 particles the same, but of course the time for a sound mode to run around is larger, and so these oscillations happen at lower frequency. And you see the offset here quite clearly. I think it really is a constant. Sorry?
What is the interaction potential?
Interaction potential? Oh, the interaction potential is, can draw it here. It's a square shoulder, so it's a hard core to a certain distance, and then it is constant up to another distance, and then it drops to zero. And this distance is smaller, or at most equal to the size of the core, by which you prevent the occurrence of next nearest neighbor interactions. So that makes the thermodynamics still quite simple. And that's like in all Herbert's models, where he always restricts the potential to just nearest neighbor. And here the hard core assures you that indeed it will be just nearest neighbor. Good, then this is for 4,000 particles. Again, simulation is here. Then you add this quadratic term from the center of mass. And if you do that, you add that to the simulation, the blue term, the blue line would give you linear behavior. And you see you're very close to that. But there is a slight offset, which is just this t to the 3/5 behavior. It fits quite nicely. I think the coefficient is not entirely in agreement with the prediction from theory for this system based on mode coupling and Herbert's and Preerhofer's exact solution. It's off by some factor, but the power law fits very, very nicely. Good. Then remark on finite size effects in diffusive systems with periodic boundary conditions. For diffusive systems with periodic boundary conditions, center of mass for long times will perform a diffusive motion with a center of mass, diffusion coefficient, which is equal to the one particle diffusion coefficient for, say, if these are independent particles that can't cross each other, divided by the number of particles on the system. So for a tech particle, then you make the same separation, xjt minus xj0. Xjt minus the average position given the position of the center of mass at time t, same at zero time, and then you have to add the fluctuation in the displacement of the center of mass. So again, you get twice the displacement of particle J from its average position squared, but now you have to add this diffusion term xt minus x0 squared, which will go as 2dt over n. So the asymptotic result is very similar to the Hamiltonian one. There is just this linear term that's added. But of course, the approach is extremely different. There are no oscillations in the Brownian system. Good, this was what I wanted to tell. Here's some list of references. So you can see that, well, the first papers on single file diffusion really appeared in the biology literature, Hodgkin and Keyes, Harris, and that Harris, this was this non-crossing Brownian particles. This is about the difference between self-diffusion in the rest frame and in the frame where you follow the Brownian, the average speed of the Brownian particle, and this, well, it's the same. Okay, thank you for your attention.
So we have time for questions. Yes, Joel?
Maybe just a comment to add to this. There are several papers by Shelley Goldstein, Edward Beer, and myself doing the same problem or some of the same problems in a rigorous general way. I think the results are obviously the same, but derivation is much more mathematical. I think we also have some other things, but I cannot remember exactly.
Well, there are about 20 or 30 papers that could be added to this list.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, so if not, let's thank Henk again. And the next speaker is...